Numbers chapter 21. Pull it up, verse 4. Numbers 21, verse 4. And they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to compass the land of Edom, and the soul of the people was much discouraged because of the way. And you want to know what is discouraging people today? It is because of the way. It's not easy to stay encouraged when you're in the way. And one of the ways to get out of that condition is to get out of the way. If you're discouraged because of the way, it's probably because you're in the way of what God wants to do in your life. This being in the way is not always exciting. Can you say amen? It's not always happy, 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 up, up, up. You know, we were in the way yesterday, trust me. And it just about drained all of our strength. I mean, and finally, we got the last job done with my amusement rides. My wife said, she usually does this. She says, while they're working, I'll go get them something to eat. And I've learned now to say, no! Because you go get them something to eat, we sure enough are not going to get through this job today. Give me 15 more minutes, we will be through. Then we'll all go eat. She said, okay. She's learned to follow my lead now. That's one of the big miracles of being married 45 years. And when I work too hard, and I don't let anybody play, and the kids hate it. But when I play hard. So I sat in Wendy's yesterday, and I knew what they wanted. They wanted to go to Denny's. It would cost me about $4,682, and I had Wendy's on my mind. And they wanted milkshakes at Denny's, which is $5.50, I'm sure. And I had Frosties on my mind. And I knew if I could pack them with some Wendy's. So I stood up there at the counter, and on the dollar menu, I spent $42. I got everything. I got potatoes. I got those French fries with those bacon chips and cheese and the French fries. Woo, hallelujah. And I got those tubs of, what do you call that, chili. Oh, yeah, chili. And chili is not very chili. It's very hot, to tell you the truth. But they call it chili. Who knows why they call it chili? But anyway, and I sat there, and I started goofing off. And I told the kids, well, if you hallucinate, it goes like this. And I waved my hand like this. Do you like the colors? LSD, you know. Look at the colors. You see that color? Look at this color. And I was goofing off and having a grand old time. My wife was trying to correct me, but she couldn't help me that time, you know, because I'm playing hard now. You understand that? And so we're in the Wendy's there, and I get $42 worth of food. We brought four or five. It looked like we wouldn't get halfway through all that food. I'm telling you, we had the whole table was piled up with food. And potatoes with cheese. Oh, aren't y'all getting hungry already? And so we were there having a grand old time. And we were enjoying the way, because sometimes you need a little change of pace, because the way can be hard, but God has some times of refreshing. God has some times of refreshing. But when you get in the way, and the way becomes monotonous, and the way becomes doing the same old thing every day, you can become discouraged because of the way. Next verse. Next verse, and the people spoke against what? And against who? No, Pastor Bennett. That's they spoke against God and against their pastor. And they said, why have you brought us here to Hopewell? To be in an air building. I said, okay, I'll give them a metal building. Why have you brought us into this building that looks like we're in a poofy cloud? Hello? And, you know, and we never seem to be growing. We're not growing because of the murmuring and the complaining. But now, thank God, we are growing. Somebody shout amen. And I'll tell you, we're growing so much now, God's even sending us our Jewish brothers and sisters back. Stand up. Shout amen. Come on, stand up. Doesn't he look wonderful? All right. That's a beautiful couple. Amen. So, who knows? What we need are some more folk in here. And there's some exciting things happening. So people are getting excited about Joy Fellowship in a way they have not before. Can you say amen? But the people that were in the way, and then the way became hard, they spoke against God and against Moses, and they said, why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no bread, neither is there any water, and our soul hates this manna from heaven. Next verse. And the Lord, let me say it again. And the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and much people of Israel died. Who sent the fiery serpents? But I heard at my Word of Faith seminar, God doesn't ever do anything negative. He only does positive things. And God never kills anybody. He took his hand off and the devil killed him. This says the Lord sent the fiery serpents. And they bit the people and much of the people of Israel died. Next verse. Therefore, the people came to Moses and said, wait a minute, wait a minute. See, one of the reasons why people are sick is because they murmur and complain against God's leadership and the leadership that God's put over them. It's easy to nitpick leadership. Well, I don't know. I just think Sister Mimi has too much power in the church. Hush your mouth. Shut up. Silence! I kill you. Hold steady, honey. I'm still having a good time from all the way that I was in yesterday. And so, but the people had sense enough to know why they had fiery serpents. God did not put a billboard up and say, because you have murmured against me and against my man, I'm sending fiery serpents, so get ready for them. They just came. They came because they were murmuring. They came because they were complaining. And this seems to indicate that what they were doing was sinning. And so the people, they weren't like the people of our day. I don't know where this came from. You know, we were doing pretty good. It must be because of Mimi and Pastor Bennett. No, they said, wait a minute. Mimi was here, Pastor Bennett was here, and God was here, and now we got fiery serpents. And that's when the song broke out in the camp. Not my brother, not my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Sometimes sickness comes upon us. Sometimes fiery serpents of hell comes upon us. Sometimes disease comes upon us. And my wife and I, many, 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 many years ago, because we grew up in churches that taught this kind of thing that you're not taught anymore today. And the thing we learned was, if something changes, first place to research is your own little self. It may be something in your little red wagon that you're pulling. It may not be the other guy. You better first search your own heart. For out of your heart flows the issues of life. And if you got issues, check your heart. Y'all aren't listening to me today. But it says the people said, we have sinned. And they knew why. They knew why. Because we have spoken against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord that he take away the serpents from us. And Moses prayed for the people. And God said something. Next verse. And the Lord said to Moses, make you a fiery serpent, set it on a pole, and it shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten, when he looks on it, shall live. Next verse. And Moses made a serpent of brass, brass meaning judgment, and he put it on a pole. He made a serpent of brass, put it on a pole. It came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. Next verse. And the children of Israel set forward and pitched their tent in Oboth. Okay. So they figured out why the fiery serpents came. Evidently, they died off because it doesn't say they kept getting bit by them. But it says that he made a fiery serpent out of brass, formed something out of brass. Now, that's quite a trick in that day, because I'm really not sure they were really brass workers back then. Brass is sort of brittle. But it made this thing out of brass, put it on a pole, and it put it up, and everyone that looked at it lived. And I assert to you, knowing human nature the way I know it, there were people that got bitten by the serpents, and they went like this. I ain't going to look at that thing. I don't care what Moses says. I ain't looking at it. God wants to take me, he can take me. I said to a man the other day, no matter what you've done, God can forgive you. I don't want God to forgive me, he said. I said, what? I want to not so quickly say, oh, Lord, forgive me, and then the Lord forgives me, and I go about my merry way. I want to grovel in this thing to make sure that I won't do it again. I want to earn my forgiveness. You asceticize yourself. It's called asceticism. I looked at that man and I said, look, listen, give me about 3 hours. I'm going to go home. I'm going to take a stick of wood, about, you know, something about the size of, you know, bigger than a handle on a broom, and I'm going to make me a handle, and I'm going to put something in the end of that handle to hold the strips of string that has glass attached to it and some leather strips on it, and I just want to bring it back to you so you can really get the full benefit. And you stand there and do like this with it. And cut yourself on your back. Crawl up the steps to the First Baptist Church on your hands and knees. Put glass down before you crawl up those steps. Roll around on a bed of nails. Earn your forgiveness. Bless God. There are people that are condemning you for looking and living. Condemning you for just looking, because he was wounded for our transgressions. And it is written, cursed is every man that hangs on a tree. And when you look at Jesus Christ, you're forgiven of your sins. When you look, you're healed. Somebody shout amen. Get it ready. Get it straight in your mind. Unforgiveness will turn you over to the tormentors. But if you have sin in your heart, you're in trouble if you don't ask forgiveness. And the only way to be forgiven, though you grovel and roll around in glass, though you beat yourself, though you mar your body, though you give your body to be burned, you cannot get forgiveness any other way than the way God's word says that you get forgiveness. You must confess your sins. He's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Somebody say amen. I want you to turn with me to Psalms chapter 66, verse 18. And hear this and hear it well. If you find yourself with sickness in your body, ask God to uncover any sin in your life, because sin will bring sickness. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. Make no provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. Make no provision. Don't hide in the secret chamber of your computer pictures of naked women. I'm talking to the men. Don't hide in your tool pouch in the trunk of your car, knowing your wife will never look at a tool pouch because that's only for men getting ready to change a tire. Be sure your sins will find you out. Your wife will have a flat tire when you're nowhere around. Don't hide that magazine. I think it's Hustler and Playboy and Q. I never learned how to pronounce the Q part. Q-U-I, I think it is. Hello. And then there's a bunch that I ain't ever heard of. You say, Pastor, did you ever look at one of those books? Yeah, listen, when I smoked marijuana, I inhaled it. No, I looked at the magazine, but I didn't open it up to the centerfold. Hello, hello. How can anybody ever believe that? And who would want a pastor that never looked at least once? Y'all aren't even with me. You want your pastor to be squeaky clean and absolutely to be sinless. My name is not Jesus Christ. And I'm sure that there are plenty of opportunities for Jesus to look at a little leg. And I'm sure he probably saw some leg, but he didn't dwell on it. And I'm sure if I saw some leg, I may dwell on it. But we had a good instructor in Bible college. He taught us, you young pastors, let me tell you some good advice. If you're going to look, take a long look, hallelujah, because a second look's a sin. And we didn't want a sin. So when we looked a long look, hallelujah, and we still had to repent. Because at some point when you do the long look, you already there, folks. But I got a verse for you. There's none righteous, no, not one. But if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. So, the second reason why people are sick is they have sin in their life, unrepented sin, and some of that sin could be just as easy as being in a position where you refuse to forgive someone their trespasses. You've got to make sure you maintain a place in your heart where you stay in constant forgiveness of everyone. I forgive all of you all for speaking against me. I forgive you right now. Hallelujah. Because I'm so big and mighty and so full of spiritual pride that I keep all. No. One time a man came up to me and said, I forgive you for what you did. And I said, hello? What did I do? Well, I don't want to talk about it, but I forgive you. I said, well, do me a favor. Don't forgive me. Don't ever forgive me again till you can tell me what I did. If you can forgive me without telling me, then just forgive me without telling me. I don't want to know it. Because there is none righteous, no, not one. Paul the Apostle said when he started out on his journey, he said, I'm the chiefest among the apostles. And before he died, he wrote, I'm the chiefest of sinners. Because the closer you get to God, the further away you know you really are. It takes an arrogant young person in Christ to think you got it made. I don't think I've got it made. I am believing God that before I take my last breath, that he'll do it with me in such a way. I mean, I don't want to suffer a real long time, but I want long enough to be able to call my wife and say, honey, I love you, and if I have ever said or done anything to hurt you, would you forgive me? I want to keep my account short. And I want every relationship that I have to be a relationship where I'm asking for forgiveness. I'd rather ask too much than not enough. Somebody say amen. And so today I say to all of you, if you have murmured against me or if you have not murmured against me, I don't know if you have. In fact, I don't think any of you have because it'd be hard to murmur against someone as perfect as I. But just in case you have murmured against me, I'm not going to stand up here and say I forgive you because I don't know if you did it. But I'm going to say this to you. I want you to forgive me for anything and everything that I've ever said or done that hurt you in any way whatsoever. I'm asking for forgiveness today. Because there's a certain amount of arrogance in some people that forgive. I want to ask you to forgive me. Because as far as I know, I have nothing in my heart against any of y'all except just two or three here. How many see the deceptiveness of this forgiveness thing? How many of you see that you need to live a life where you are asking for forgiveness and in your heart forgive everyone? And when you forgive me, you don't have to come up and tell me, because then it'll make me not want to forgive you. I know none of you struggle with these things. Hidden sin. Everybody say hidden sin. Is one of the reasons why people are sick. Those people murmuring against Moses, he didn't know who they were. He heard the stories, but he had no idea how many. If he'd have known how many people were murmuring, he might have resigned. Okay, I don't want to be president anymore. He didn't really know how bad it was with his sister Miriam when she got leprosy. When she got leprosy, he said, Miriam, what's going on? Well, God told me it's because of you, Moses. Well, what did I do? Well, I got upset with you because you were getting so much respect from everybody, and if it wasn't for me, you wouldn't even be here. It was me that put you as a little baby in the bulrush and put you in a little basket and floated you down the Nile River. It was me that ran alongside to make sure you didn't flip out of that little basket and drown yourself. I spared your life. I saved your life. It was me that brought mother over to the Pharaoh's daughter. And now, Moses, I saw how God used you, and I started seeking God. And I want to tell you this, Moses, I'm just anointed as you are. And Moses said, is that all? He says, yeah. She said, no, there's one more thing. You married a black woman. And God said to me one day in the night, he said, you like white? I'll show you white. And he smote me white with leprosy. And Moses, oh God, my sister's a jerk, but she is my sister. Would you please forgive her? Will you take this leprosy away from her? And God said, if it had been anybody else, at least they'd have to stay outside the camp for a week. She has to stay outside the camp for a week. I'm not going to forgive her for 1 week. She needs to learn her lesson. God don't mess around with prejudice. He doesn't mess around with unforgiveness. He doesn't mess around with arrogance. He doesn't mess around with being lifted up in pride. He doesn't mess around with you groveling in your sickness and saying, why'd this happen to me? All I've ever done is try to serve you, Lord. It doesn't make any difference. He didn't mess around with Job. He let the comforters come, which were really the harassers. They weren't comforters, they were harassers. And he let the harassers come. He let them belittle him. He let them put him down. And it was a year and a half later that Job finally cried out to God, and he says, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. And in my flesh, one day I'm going to see my God. If I die, I die. If I live, I live. And God said to Job, Job, you did really good, but I got an assignment for you, because I can tell that these people have been getting under your skin. I can tell you got a little attitude toward these people that have been coming up accusing you of all these things. Well, what do you think, God? Only you could let people talk to you like they're talking to me and not be upset. God says, here's the formula for your deliverance. Pray for your enemies. Pray for your comforters. Pray for your harassers. And when he prayed for them, he was healed. Little attitudes can hold you in sickness, can keep you in disease, can make your immunity system fall apart. Is anybody listening to me today? Would you rather that I had preached a message today on how to be happy, happy, happy? I'm telling you, murmuring against God's servants brings fiery serpents in your life. Hidden sin brings sickness on your life. Look at the palsy. Matthew 9, verse 2. Matthew 9, verse 2. This is an amazing story. No one seems to put this together, but I'm going to put it together for you today. Behold, they brought to him a man sick of the palsy, lying on a bed. And Jesus, seeing the faith of the people that had brought him there, said to the sick of the palsy, "Be healed." And the sick of the palsy rose up and was healed. Is that what it says? You see, for Jesus to get healing through to the sick of the palsy, he said to the sick of the palsy, "Your sins be forgiven you." And then, instead of the people getting excited because a healing was about to take place, a miracle's taking place, they started debating whether Jesus, what he said, was scripturally correct or not. Next verse, they go, and behold, certain of the scribes said to them, "This man blasphemes. Next verse, and Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, "Why think you evil in your hearts?" Next verse, whether it's easier to say your sins be forgiven you or arise and walk. But he forgave the man his sins, because the reason the man was sick because of sins in his life. Come on, somebody, say hello, Dolly. You didn't say hello, Dolly. I got to quit. Say hello, Dolly. Jesus moves with compassion, and he moves to the source of the reason why you're sick. Some people are sick because they murmur against God's servant. Be careful not to murmur against God's servant, and don't murmur against God. Don't say, "God, why did you let this happen to me?" Don't murmur against God. Say, "God, I don't understand it. I am really left in the dark on this matter. Please show me the bigger picture. I know you got a bigger picture somewhere, and I will trust you with my life." Don't ever accuse God, and don't ever murmur against his anointed ones. The anointed ones are not right all the time. We mess up. Everybody say, "We mess up." Now tell it like it is. Say, "The pastor and the leadership messes up sometimes, but I will not murmur against them, because I don't want fiery serpents biting me in the middle of the night. I don't want to die young." See, but I'm not going to let hidden sin in my life. You got hidden sin? You're open for sickness. Today, make it clear in your own heart. If I have unforgiveness in my heart, I've got hidden sin. See, secret sins are secret because nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Nobody knows but Jesus. And you got these hidden secret sins in your life, and don't think you're going to be healed. You're not going to be healed though you fast and pray 21 days. And until angels appear in your house and play the harps and the songs of Zion to you, you still won't be healed. Because if you have hidden sin in your heart, If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. The sick of the palsy was sick of the palsy because he had sin in his life. He had a Playboy magazine underneath his little stretcher. I don't know what he was doing, folks. And I don't think really Playboy is the real key to this thing. I think the hidden sin people have in their heart is they're lifted up in pride. I think that they have these little foxes that are spoiling the vine. I think they have these little devious things, something that they did in the past and they weren't willing to expose it. If you confess and forsake your sin, you'll have mercy. That's what the Bible says. But if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. So today, we've uncovered two more reasons why people are sick. They're sick because of murmuring and complaining. They're sick because of hidden sin. And Jesus forgives the man his sins. And then he heals the man. And when he does the thing that's going to bring healing, you'd be amazed at how many people try to talk you out of your healing. Well, he didn't do it right. He is supposed to anoint him with oil first. Jesus didn't always anoint people with oil. Some people he just flat out healed. Somebody say he just flat out healed some people. I said he flat out healed them. Some people he got them healed by forgiving their sin. Some people he got them straight and he said, look, if you just look to the cross, you'll be healed. And many people today won't even look at the cross. And the fiery serpents are still biting them. And they're still dying like flies. But if you just look, you'll be healed. So we have using your sickness 2 weeks ago. We have murmuring against God's servants today. Hidden sin today. And next week, would you like to know what we're going to talk about? It's a secret. You'll have to come back next week when it's not my anniversary. Thank you for coming today for my anniversary. But don't leave this place today until you say, Lord, forgive me. If I have ever used my sickness, forgive me. You know, you may legitimately have toothaches. You may legitimately have intestinal disorders. But if you say when you don't have them, oh, my intestines are acting up again, whoop, you're just saying, come in, devil, come in. Well, what we need to say is, I will not, as an inhabitant of the land, say I am sick. I will fight and scratch and claw to get back from the sickness that I have used. And it may take me 6 months or 6 years, but I'm not going to die young because I use sickness. I'm not going to die young because I murmur and complain at what God's trying to do in my life and murmur and complain against leadership. I'm not going to die young because I have unforgiveness in my heart and because I have hidden sin in my life. No sin is worth dying 20 years early. I feel like I'm preaching to the air. I'm beating the air here. I want to tell you something today. This is critical. There are people sitting here today that will carry secrets to their grave, and no secret is worth going to your grave. At least give me this much. When the doctors say you only got 6 months to live, call all your family in and say, I screwed up here, I screwed up there, I screwed up, and confess all your sins. And he will be faithful and just to forgive you of your sins, and you might just get up from your deathbed and live another 20 years. Somebody shout amen. Because murmuring, complaining will take you out of here early. Hidden sin will take you out of here early. Using your sickness will take you out of here early. And next week, you ain't seen nothing yet. Are you ready for it? Raise your hands to heaven and say, Lord, forgive me. if I've ever used a sickness. Forgive me, Lord, for hidden sin in my life. Forgive me, Lord, for murmuring and complaining against you and your people that you've put over me. In Jesus' name, amen. If this message has pricked your heart today, deal with it. Whatever you do, don't leave here saying, he said that because he was talking to me. I was not talking to you. I was talking to you. Have no idea who you are. I'm preaching truth today. Deal with it. Don't let the devil destroy the potential of your life. I'll share things in the next couple of weeks that will blow your mind. I will tell you the story of a woman whose mother died of a certain type of cancer. And until the day the mother died, that mother prophesied over people till the day she died. Powerfully used of God on her deathbed even. When the mother died, the daughter got the same disease. A curse from a previous generation. And she set in my service, when I preach this sermon on the seven reasons why people are sick. And the lights came on into her inner spirit. And she said, my God, I'm sitting here with a secret that I have the same symptoms of my mother and I've never even told my husband and I've never gone to the doctor to get it checked. She was playing I've Got a Secret with a sickness in her life. A curse from a previous generation. And when I preached all of this. It took me 2 hours to preach the whole message. And when I got through preaching that message, I sent people out. She went running out to the restroom. She checked. She came back in shouting, it's gone, it's gone, it's gone. Her husband said, what's gone, honey? She said, I wasn't telling anybody. It was going to be my secret between me and the Lord. And I would have been taken out of this world with this cancer of the rectum. She says, but it left me. It flowed from my body. And I am made whole today. And she lives today because the devil is tricky. And he will hold you in sickness. Sneakily hold you. Sneakily destroy the potential of your life. This woman had even prayed, Lord, just let me live to see my children graduate from high school. I know another man that prayed, oh God, let me live to see my children get married. And when the last one got married, he dropped dead. Don't make a deal with the devil. Lord, I believe you to keep me alive as long as you have need for me on this earth. And I believe you to not let previous generations' curses come down on me. I believe you, Lord, to keep me from murmuring and complaining. I believe you, Lord, to keep me from hidden sin. If I expose my sin, it's no longer hidden. Somebody say amen. And I will never again use sickness to get out of doing some work. A girl in my revival said, she came screaming to the front of the church after I got through preaching. She said when she was 12 years old, they were going to run around the track. So she sat on the bleachers and she faked an asthma attack. She went like this. She did that 4 or 5 times to get out of doing exercise at school. and asthma came on her like a railroad. And that night she repented from the asthma, went home, almost died of asthma attack. And I told her that's what was going to happen. I said, you'll probably have the worst asthma attack you ever had in your life tonight because the devil's going to have to let go. I cursed that asthma in the name of Jesus, this asthma that she had been using. That night they rushed her to the medical center, full alert. They worked on her till 5 o'clock in the morning. All of a sudden, her lungs became free. Her throat became unstopped. Her sinus passages opened up, and she rose up from that bed, and she said to her mother, I will never use asthma again as a way of getting out of doing the chores around the house. She started using that asthma for everything she didn't want to do. And that night, she was made totally whole. Somebody shout amen. You got to get it right in your heart. You got to have freedom in your heart. And only God knows what's in your heart. And you say, Lord, right now, everybody, once again, because it's too critical. I don't want people going out of here criticizing the message, second-guessing what I'm preaching. I've been knowing these truths for many years. God forgive me for not preaching them more in this church. Raise your hands high, everybody, and act like you mean it and say, Lord, forgive me for everything that I've ever done or said that's not been pleasing to you. Forgive me for using sickness in any way, shape, and form. Forgive me for murmuring and complaining against your servants and against you. And forgive me, Lord, for hidden sin. I will expose my life. I expose my life to you today, Lord. And I will confess my sins, not to the world, not the people that are going to chew me up and spit me out. But I'll confess my sins, and I will never do those things again if you'll give me strength. In Jesus' name, amen. Can you clap your hands today and say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. When we get through this series, I'm going to give you a chance to respond. Because here's what the Lord showed me. If you're sick today and it's not point one, two, or three, and when we talk about the other one, it's not four, five, six, or seven, and we get to the last one. See, the devil will try to condemn you and hold you in sickness when it's really the last one. And the last one, if you uncover all these other things and it's not the first six, then you can run to the front and say, I'm free, I'm free, I'm free. The devil can't hold me in bondage anymore. And you will walk out from underneath your sickness. You'll walk out from underneath your disease. Because I'll give you a little glimpse. The last one is lack of faith. Whew. If it's not one, two, three, four, five, or six, then you can start shouting, I do have faith, and devil, you're a liar. I'm not going to be sick anymore because I am the healed of God. And you can be made totally whole. Can you wave your hands to the Lord? Can you shout hallelujah? Can you say praise the Lord? Say, I will be free. Sickness will not hold me. Sin will not hold me. Unforgiveness will not hold me. I will be free. Come on, clap your hands. Somebody stomp your feet. Somebody make some noise and say, by his stripes I was healed.